sitting in G11. Congratulations, you've just won a paid round-trip vacation. Fourth Grove City of the World to Bridgeport, Connecticut for tea has won our second prize. 2 weeks in Bridgeport. My cousin's a weird guy. But my cousin got picked up last week for standing on the side of a road, you know, like with his thumb out and holding up a big sign that said Bridgeport. The police booked him for hitchhiking, temporary insanity. You can always tell a newcomer to Bridgeport. He's the guy who's still got the hubcaps left in his car.
The old Bridgeport myth, the product of two generations of comics and jokesters. But in the 1970s, the old Bridgeport myth is dead. Aristotle said, people come together in cities to live. They stay in cities to live the good life. Bridgeport, Toward the Good Life, is presented in the interest of a better community by the 250,000 members of the People's Savings Bank family. Fairfield County, Connecticut, part of the greater New York area, center of the nation's commerce and communications. Fairfield County, Connecticut's richest, the divergent southwestern key to progress in the great nutmeg state. Greater Bridgeport, at the very center of Fairfield County's commerce, enterprise, and industry. Greater Bridgeport, 8 distinctly unique towns and cities which together form a complete community. And at its heart, Bridgeport, the commercial and cultural core, the Park City, providing direction for the whole of this complete community. But Bridgeport has not always been Fairfield County's major city. There was a time when Bridgeport was a town of the waterfront, relying heavily on Long Island Sound for commerce and travel. It was a time when even her name reflected her intimacy with the Sound, Pequannock, or the place where the river meets the sea. But then the railroad came to replace the more conventional modes of transportation. It was a day when one could travel from Bridgeport to New York for a single, and it brought new commerce and activity. It also brought new faces. At the dawn of this railroad age, in 1836, she was formally incorporated as a city, with a population of only 4,000, but she was growing rapidly. Whaling and farming were still mysteries, but the emphasis was toward the good life of the city. Two newspapers was a certain measure of theatrical entertainment. The end of the Civil War gave Bridgeport and America a chance to catch up with Europe's Industrial Revolution. And with steam, the great new source of power, industries began to flourish. The Union Metallic Cartridge Company, now Remington Arms, and the Bridgeport Brass Company were formed, and by the turn of the century, Bridgeport was well established as an important industrial center. The great new age of commerce was underway. The Bridgeporter has long had an eye for beauty and an hour or two for fun. There was always time for sports and recreation. Baseball, swimming, and girl watching, always favorites in this city on the Sound. So from the beginning, Bridgeporters have been moving toward the good life, and the economic foundation for all this movement has been the city's industrial base. Today, with more than 6,500 employees, Sikorsky Aircraft Company is Greater Bridgeport's largest employer. Its president, Wesley Kurt.
In the South Avenue plant at the present time, we have about 600 employees. The rest of the employees are primarily here at the Stratford operation. the skilled employees are a group of employees which have been representative of the type of industry which has been attracted and built up over the many years within Connecticut. And, of course, a great deal of this has centered in Bridgeport itself because this is essentially an industrial city. I think the other thing that's attractive is probably the what I would call the professional skills which are developed here. Right now, I would say that we are more encouraged regarding the future than we have been for many years. Only recently we have been awarded a very significant development. It could lead into large in contract. And in this case, this would mean, of course, a great deal of employment in this area. I think that other industries could be attracted here. This is an attractive place, an attractive location. It's close to the to a kind of New York City without the some of the unfortunate things that are associated with living in and around New York City.
A city is known by the companies it keeps. Bridgeport is proud to house the corporate headquarters of Harvey Hubble, Raybestos Manhattan, Warnico, and American Chain and Cable. In the near future, Greater Bridgeport will also be the home of the General Electric Company's world corporate headquarters. These companies, and others like Avco and Bullard, have laid the groundwork for the city's development and growth in other areas. One of Bridgeport's leading citizens, a recent president of the Greater Bridgeport Chamber of Commerce and a People's Savings Bank vice president, is Jack Zellers.
From our vantage point atop the Holiday Inn in downtown Bridgeport, we get a marvelous view of the Grand South Panorama of Bridgeport. Less than a mile away, we see Long Island Sound with its many recreational possibilities, such as boating and fishing and water skiing, and even very fine beaches. And then as we look to the west, we see Park City Hospital, one of three modern hospitals to serve the needs of the community, both in Bridgeport and the surrounding towns. Of course, right below us here, we see the transportation hub. We see routes 25 and 8 coming off the Connecticut Turnpike so that we have a true east, west, and north service for automobiles. And this service provides an opportunity for the residents of Newtown, Trumbull, and other cities and towns to the north of us to get into Bridgeport very quickly. In back of me is the People's Savings Bank building. There are other large banks in Fairfield County with headquarters in Bridgeport, such as the City National Bank, the new State National Bank Tower, and the Connecticut National Bank, to just mention just a few. And then, of course, right here below us is Lafayette Shopping Plaza, which anchors the southern end of Bridgeport's Central Business District Shopping Center. It has the largest parking garage in this country, and it has many fine shops and stores, not only within it, but also very close to it.
Downtown Bridgeport, once a slum area, has enjoyed a thorough renovation. New federal and state courthouses have contributed to this new life in the center city. Bridgeport no longer relies on her close proximity to the water for transportation as she did in the early 19th century. A modern highway system, the latest in rail transportation, and a new airport have replaced the steamboat of yesteryear. Even so, her harbor remains a valuable municipal asset. Captain Fleischel, commander of the Long Island Sound Division of the United States Coast Guard.
The last published statistics in 1970 indicated that 3.8 million tons of cargo moved into Bridgeport. Three quarters of the cargo which moves into Bridgeport is petroleum-based products. Steel, cement, and construction materials also moved in great tonnages. We feel that in time, Bridgeport is going to grow even larger. Over the last 10 years, it has quadrupled the tonnage that has moved into the harbor. It, like other ports in the Sound, offers great potential for growth. The Sound itself, as an ecological entity, is going to offer more and more to the citizenry of the Connecticut as it is cleaned up through the medium of state and federal laws and action. Bridgeport and some of its concerned citizens have taken some action to improve the quality of the port.
Bridgeport is served by one of the most complete medical communities in New England. Park City Hospital in the city's southwestern sector was founded in 1924 with only 36 beds. Today, the hospital has a total bed capacity of more than 200 and offers a complete range of health care facilities. A second full-service medical complex is located in the north-central part of the city. St. Vincent's Hospital, currently equipped and staffed to serve nearly every patient need, is in the midst of a $30 million building program which will expand total bed capacity to more than 400 and provide even more patient services. The city's third medical facility is on Bridgeport's east side. With nearly 700 beds, Bridgeport Hospital is among the largest and most complete medical centers in Eastern America. Dr. Pasquale Pirelli is Bridgeport Hospital's chief of medicine.
Bridgeport has been selected as one of the satellite university complexes in the New England area. And amongst the reasons for that selection, I'm sure, are our geographical location, but also the fact that we now have within our area a large, modern, up-to-date hospital. We do have a large active hemodialysis unit now. That is a unit where patients with chronic and acute kidney disease can be treated by use of artificial kidneys. One thing that we do not have available to us is the expertise nor the facilities for transplantation surgery. So that in our hemodialysis program, we are integrated with the university, and our patients being managed on our dialysis unit are, if they desire, included in the transplantation program at the universities. Any patient known to have suffered an acute heart attack, an acute myocardial infarction, is admitted immediately to that unit, where they are then placed on constant electronic monitors to monitor the heart rate and the heart rhythm, and have on duty in that unit a group of nurses who have been especially trained to manage and take care of patients with acute cardiac problems. The overall results of our CCU, like all of the CCUs, is that the acute mortality rate from heart attacks has been reduced one-third. That is, prior to our having a coronary care unit, roughly 35% of people with an acute heart attack died. Now, roughly 10% die.
A nationally known rehabilitation center is connected by corridor to Bridgeport Hospital, together with a new mental health center. These facilities and a well-established nursing school form a large, highly specialized medical complex. The people of the greater Bridgeport community are also justifiably proud of their five colleges and universities, which have jointly created the Higher Education Study Center. Dr. Parker Lansdale is its director.
Actually, higher education in the greater Bridgeport area is one of the major industries, though most people don't think of it in this sense. In straight economic terms, it represents annual expenditures in this area of $15 to $25 million, depending on whether you describe construction costs as well as salaries paid to individuals and expenditures by students and so on in the community. You're really talking about a major enterprise that brings into this area and provides academic opportunities for some 15 to 18,000 different students. 3.5 years ago, these five schools came together and created, in cooperation with the city of Bridgeport, the Higher Education Center for Urban Studies. Essentially, if you look at it in terms of purpose, its primary function and orientation was at the question, what is it that the five of us can do together better in cooperation with the city than we could do separately?
Next to Boston, Bridgeport has the largest college population in New England. The University of Bridgeport is the largest of the city's universities. The Sacred Heart University campus is also the site of the Bridgeport Engineering Institute. Housatonic Community College and Fairfield University offer additional programs and facilities. The uniqueness of Bridgeport's university community is the enormous variety of curricula and opportunities it provides area residents. Private and public, large and small, urban and suburban, these five colleges are divergent in their offerings, but united in their purpose. Beyond the classroom and the laboratory, the area's universities attempt to deal with the concerns of the whole of the greater Bridgeport community. Again, HECUS Director Parker Lansdale.
The program areas have tended to be in those segments of the community which were most in need of help. HECUS has been very instrumental in bringing faculty resources to bear on model cities, providing opportunities for students in the model cities area with financial help from model cities to attend the colleges and universities of their choice. The closest thing I suppose we have to open admissions in, as an experiment in the greater Bridgeport areas, is this Model Cities program.
The Burroughs Building houses the central collection of the Bridgeport Public Libraries. With more than 400,000 volumes, the library system is considered to be one of the finest in southern New England. The building itself was recently renovated to provide special services for virtually every segment of Bridgeport's population. There's an outstanding children's library with more than 25,000 volumes and a staging area for skits and plays, a special juvenile section, a technology and business department to serve the business community, and a library program for senior citizens. The renovations also include improvements to aid the handicap. In addition to the main library, there are five branch facilities and collections in St. Vincent's and Bridgeport hospitals. But the Bridgeport Library is only the most visible facet of a great cultural community in the city. The Barnum Museum and the Museum of Art, Science, and Industry offer superb collections and unique programs. Literally hundreds of musical and dramatic productions are staged annually by the city's universities and through the community concerts program. The Shakespeare Theater in Stratford has attracted a national audience. Jim Jolly, a recent president of the Bridgeport Symphony Society.
Like many symphonies throughout the country, we've certainly had our ups and downs, but we're moving along at a good rate. We support the youth orchestra, the youngsters from the greater Bridgeport school system. They went over and performed in London. This has been very encouraging to the senior symphony and, of course, to the youngsters, because they, of course, will be our musicians in the future with the Greater Bridgeport Symphony. We are very optimistic about the future of the Greater Bridgeport Symphony.
In addition to his long-term association with the Bridgeport Symphony Society, Jim Jolly has long been involved in many other cultural and social projects in Bridgeport. As a result, he is able to capably appraise the future of the city.
Bridgeport is going nowhere but up, as evidenced by what's going on around downtown Bridgeport. We are now getting more diversified in our manufacturing and research operations. We are really in Fairfield County, in a fast-growing area. Everything you see on the long-range planning, whether it's the regional planning group, or whether it's a survey taken by our own company, for example, the telephone company, we see unprecedented growth in the next 25 years in Bridgeport. And as a result of that, the Bridgeport community and residents in this area are going to benefit by this constant growth.
Golf courses, tennis courts, public beaches, baseball diamonds, football fields, and basketball courts, horseshoe pits, a city zoo, and plenty of open spaces, all freely available to the citizens of the city, all further testament to the fact that Bridgeport is a people's town. But the Park City is not all playgrounds and prosperity. Like every other urban center, there are segments of Bridgeport's population facing serious problems. Among the dozens of organizations striving to find meaningful solutions for these problems is Hall Neighborhood House. Alfredo Rebott is its spokesman.
Hall Neighborhood House was formed in the early part of this century. At one time, it originally was known as Associated Charities. The charities was basically organized to help young women, mainly unwed mothers. Through the years, got a board of directors and finally became known as the Hall Neighborhood House, which became a agency or a part of the National Settlement Homes. Today, the agency is located on the east side of Bridgeport, or the Model Cities neighborhood. This was during the early 50s that it came into the east side of Bridgeport, which has been designated as one of the most deprived areas of the city of Bridgeport. Like most deprived areas of major cities, there is a terrible housing shortage. The educational levels of our schools in this neighborhood are not up to par. We have a drug addiction problem. Behind us here, you will see the two geodesic domes, which serve as two daycare centers. The concept is unique, and we believe they're the only centers of their kind in the United States. The funds for the centers came through the Model Cities program, and presently they are servicing approximately 40 children. The uniqueness of the domes is that through the efforts of a young man, a young student from the University of Bridgeport, and a local architect, the domes were put together and designed not only by professionals, but by local people.
P.T. Barnum, the great showman and longtime Bridgeport resident. Every summer, Bridgeport stages one of the great American pageants in honor of his spirit, the incomparable Barnum Festival. Thank you for joining us as we have looked at some of the points of pride in our community. Although the city faces many problems common to urban centers, she offers a great variety of commercial, industrial, cultural, educational, and recreational opportunities. As Bridgeport moves toward the good life, It is the spirit and pride of her people that hold the greatest promise. No great city can survive without that spirit, the very special quality that is the essence of the city's character. People's Savings Bank, Bridgeport, is far more than a place to live. That it is, indeed, a place to live the good life.